Inspired by Barcelona forward Hristo Stoichkov, Bulgaria were a force to be reckoned with at the 1994 World Cup in the United States. They beat Greece and Argentina in the group stages, Mexico in the round of 16, and the reigning world champions Germany in the quarterfinals. It would take a Roberto Baggio brace to send the Bulgarians packing in the semi-finals, but Stoichkov still managed to jointly win the World Cup Golden Boot, and later, the Ballon d'Or. It was the high point in the history of Bulgarian football, but the country had long produced the occasional gem, and CSKA Sofia had flown the nation's flag with pride in the European Cup, twice reaching the semi-finals, and recording victories against the likes of Juventus, Liverpool, and Bayern Munich. When one thinks of the zenith of Bulgarian football not being all that long ago, the decline seems all the more catastrophic. When England put 6 goals past Bulgaria in their own backyard, whilst coasting in third gear, in a game marred by off-field incidents, it was a stark exhibit of how far Bulgaria had fallen. For once, there were no star men to be found within the Bulgarian team, just a collection of misfits who would have looked more at home in League One. The contrast between them and another of England's opponents, Kosovo, who played as a unit, looked comfortable on the ball and showed real ambition, was striking, especially given that Kosovo only became UEFA members in 2016. Bulgaria are 66th in the FIFA World Rankings right now, sandwiched between North Macedonia and Saudi Arabia, and still falling. This is what their run of form looks like over the last 2 years. They are what you might call a national team in crisis. Whilst national football teams almost always ebb and flow between more and less talented groups of players, from the outside looking in, it can be difficult to understand the speed and extent of Bulgaria's decline. But when one looks into Bulgaria's domestic game, it becomes a little easier to understand. Back in August, I made a video about the fight for the identity of CSKA Sofia between two different Bulgarian clubs, and I hinted at the end that I might make a video about Ludogorets in the future. Since then, subscriber Asenseto has asked when the Ludogorets video will be coming out by my estimates, at least 50 times, so I applaud your persistence, Asenseto. I also made a recent video in which I called the Tajik League the most corrupt league on earth, to the outrage of many Bulgarian football fans who believe their top flight is more deserving of that title. So Asenseto, all Bulgarian subscribers, and indeed all non-Bulgarian subscribers, strap in and get ready for a video about PFC Ludogorets Razgrad and the wild world of Bulgarian football. Bulgaria is a country of roughly 7 million people, over 1.2 million of whom live in the nation's capital city of Sofia. Perhaps it should come as a little surprise then that clubs from the capital have historically dominated Bulgaria's football scene. Between 1945 and 1990, clubs from Sofia won 42 of a possible 45 league titles, with two of the three outliers coming from Plovdiv, Bulgaria's second largest city, and the other from Stara Zagora, which is the sixth largest city in Bulgaria. Over the last decade though, a new superpower has emerged within the Bulgarian game, emerging out of nowhere to scoop up 9 consecutive top flight league titles. So where are they based? Sofia or Plovdiv? Well, they're not from either actually, nor are they from Varna, Burgas, Ruz or Pleven, which are Bulgaria's only other cities with a population in excess of 100,000. Nope, Ludogorets are from the city of Razgrad, located in the northeast of Bulgaria, closer to the nation's famous tourist destination of Sunny Beach than it is to Sofia. Razgrad is tiny, and I mean really tiny. Home to around 35,000 people at last count, Razgrad doesn't even rank among Bulgaria's 30 largest towns and cities. It has less than 3% of Sofia's population, and even when one accounts for the entire Razgrad municipality, including all adjacent villages, you could still fit the region's entire population inside the Stadium of Light in Sunderland. The city is best known for having been the site of the Battle of Abritus in 251 AD between the Romans and the Goths, for having one of the largest mosques in the Balkans, and now for its football team, which dominates the Bulgarian game. Ludogorets are not a new club, they were founded in 1945, but they spent most of their time in Bulgaria's lowly third tier, with the odd promotion and relegation from the country's second division. The team had a few different names, and by the mid-2000s, they were looking at financial oblivion. A group of local businessmen and former players rallied around though to save the club, investing just enough money to keep the club going and support the team's youth development. In 2008, the consortium who were running the club, who had fairly modest resources, began looking for outside investors. They found a generous donor in Kirill Domusheyev, a businessman from Sofia, who had grown very wealthy over the last 18 years. As the Soviet Union fell, Bulgaria began a transition from communism to capitalism in 1990. As was the case right throughout the Soviet bloc, this transition led to some people becoming very wealthy, and Domisheyev was one of them. He and his brother Georgi founded a number of private companies during Bulgaria's period of transition, generating enough capital to start acquiring shares in still underpriced Bulgarian companies by the mid-1990s. The duo established their most successful business, a pharmaceutical company, in 1999, which now has sites in Bulgaria, Italy, and the United States. Their company, Who Pharma, has become a global player, particularly in the field of veterinary medicine, and they recently received a huge €100 million grant from the EU for research and development. Once the Domisheyev brothers began to ring the cash register at a serious rate of knots, they founded a company called Advanced Properties, which acts as a holding company for all of their diversified business interests and investments. All this has given Domisheyev an estimated net worth of $950 million, making him one of the wealthiest people in Bulgaria. Domisheyev was approached by the Ludogorets Consortium when the club was still in the third tier, and asked if he would inject just €25,000 to help the club push for promotion. He agreed, and Ludogorets won promotion to Bulgaria's second league for the first time in decades. The consortium went back to Domisheyev and this time asked for a rather more considerable investment of €250,000. The goal was to keep the ball rolling and try to thrive rather than survive in the second league and earn promotion to Bulgaria's top flight. Domisheyev agreed on one condition, that he would take ownership of the club, and in September 2010, that's exactly what he did. It's at this point that I just want to interrupt our story, although it is rather significant to the overall story, and tell you that Bulgarian football is a mess. Indeed, Bulgaria itself is in a bit of a mess. Without going off on too much of a tangent, I went to school with a boy from Bulgaria. A nice lad, despite the fact that he once chased me around on a politics trip, jabbing a safety pin into my arm. We went on that trip to get a day off school, even though neither of us actually studied politics, but no one seemed to notice. However, we did both study history, and I can remember on the day after the US presidential elections, in which Barack Obama defeated Mitt Romney, my history teacher queried to my Bulgarian friend, "Who is Bulgaria's Prime Minister, Stefan?" To which he replied, simply, "He is Mafia." "Right," said Mr. Hughes, moving swiftly on as if the conversation had never happened. "He could be a little unpredictable sometimes, Stefan, and I'm not sure if our teacher thought that he was just winding him up." Bulgaria's Prime Minister at the time was Boyko Borisov, and he still is now. A quick scan through Borisov's Wikipedia page will show you that accusations of corruption and involvement in organised crime on Borisov's part extends far beyond sixth form history classrooms in the United Kingdom. Borisov has an extremely sketchy past, and throughout 2020, there have been protests in Bulgaria and within Bulgarian diasporas overseas campaigning for his resignation, particularly after a leaked photograph appeared to show Borisov laying half-naked in bed with a gun on his nightstand and huge wads of cash. The Prime Minister claimed the photographs were doctored and that he's not going anywhere, but Bulgaria's problems with corruption run deeper than just one man. Bulgaria is the poorest country in the EU by most commonly used metrics, such as GDP per capita, and organised crime is extremely prevalent. Despite what I said about the Tajik League, Bulgaria's football league system is one of a number which can lay claim to being the most corrupt on earth, and certainly the most dangerous. Being the president of a Bulgarian football club gives you about the same life expectancy as becoming a low-level drug dealer in Sinaloa or marrying OJ Simpson. In a 10-year period, 15 Bulgarian club presidents were killed. Lokomotiv Plovdiv had 3 presidents gunned down in the space of just 2 years. These killings are thought to be related to Bulgaria's rampant corruption, with football frequently used by organised crime leaders to launder money, with match fixing also believed to be prevalent. The understanding that Bulgarian football has all too often not been legitimate competition has led to an inevitable distrust from the public, a drop in attendances, and the suspicion whenever a strange decision is made or occurrence happens that all is not quite as it seems. It was into this arena that Kirill Domisheyev and his brother Georgi stepped when they acquired Ludogorets Razgrad in 2010, a second-tier football club in a remote city best known for a big mosque. A big ruined mosque that the Turkish government is supposedly going to renovate at some stage, but a big mosque nonetheless. Just by running a football club with some sanity and injecting a little bit of cash, Eddie Owner is likely to achieve some success in Bulgarian football, and that was supposedly Domisheyev's aim. Bulgaria's second league is still a regional league, split into an East and West format, and Ludogorets entered the East B League, as it is known. They won the league title, achieving promotion to Bulgaria's top flight for the first time in the club's 66 years in existence. Domusheyev went on a spending spree. Litex Lovech had been the top flight champions the previous season, conceding just 13 goals over 30 games. So Ludogorets poached their goalkeeper and impressive French centre-back. Brazilian duo Marcelino and Janinho arrived from Portuguese outfit Bragantino. Meanwhile, future club legend Svetoslav Diakev strengthened the Minnows in midfield. All told, Domusheyev basically recruited an entire new squad of players ahead of life in the top flight, including a handful of Bulgarian internationals and some of their new rivals' best players. There was lots of envy aimed in Ludogorets' direction, and it would soon grow stronger. In their first season of top flight football, Ludogorets claimed their first Bulgarian title, defeating their biggest title rival CSKA Sofia 1-0 on the final day to leapfrog the club from Sofia to the title by just 1 point. Ludogorets have won every single Bulgarian league title since, strengthening season after season and now boasting players who reportedly earn £500,000 a year, which is a lot of money, for a domestic player in Bulgaria. It's at this point that I must draw your attention towards a disagreement between two groups of people in Bulgaria with regards to the situation at Ludogorets, namely those who back the club and those who don't. The former claim that Ludogorets' success is built upon smart ownership, youth development, and recruitment in a league where everyone else has gone mad. Ludogorets' success as a well-run club in a poorly run league is inevitable, they would suggest, with Domusheyev's deep pockets only having sped up the process. The counter-argument is that Razgrad is basically a sleepy little village with the majority Turkish population with little interest in football who have distorted Bulgarian football through their spending and perhaps even through more nefarious means. Ludogorets, some people allege, have not succeeded because they are the least corrupt team in a corrupt league, but precisely because they are the most corrupt team in an already corrupt league. Kirill Domusheyev is obviously a very powerful man within Bulgaria, whether it be in industry, politics, or football. He is a member of the Bulgarian Football Union, the governing body concerning Bulgarian football, and he is believed to hold significant sway within the organisation. Naturally, being a club president of one of Bulgaria's clubs, that has led to one or two red flags. Many rival fans allege that Domusheyev has bribed officials throughout the last 9 years, and that it is this corruption, rather than their talent, which has led to Ludogorets' dominance in Bulgaria's top flight. One subscriber to this channel even commented that since Domusheyev bought Bulgaria's largest media company, which owns the broadcasting rights for Bulgarian football, a commentator lost his job for saying that the referee made a mistake in awarding Ludogorets a penalty during a game live on TV. Of course, since there are no news stories that I can find about this, I have no way of verifying the claim, but it gives you an idea of the attitudes and allegations surrounding Ludogorets among much of the Bulgarian population. The club has now become so dominant that they are beginning to erode any remaining interest many people had in Bulgarian domestic football. Ludogorets didn't lose a single league game all of last season, and they have only lost 5 league games across the last 4 years in total. Given the sheer scale of corruption within Bulgarian football, it's difficult not to concur with those who suggest Ludogorets are in on the act, although they have certainly been aided by the implosion of Bulgaria's traditional powerhouses, most notably in the case of CSKA. Bulgarian football is a total basket case, Ludogorets included. If you want to know just how weird things are, I can think of few better examples than returning to Bulgaria's Prime Minister, the man my Bulgarian school friend referred to simply as Mafia. Prime Minister Borisov is a keen football fan himself, but he also fancies himself as a bit of a player as well. Throughout his years in office, he has also played football for Thirty side Vitosha Bystrica, for who he has apparently scored 27 goals in 23 games over the space of 7 years. I mean, just imagine Theresa May lining up a free kick for Fleetwood Town, or Donald Trump bombing down the wing for the Richmond Kickers, because that's essentially what we're talking about here. In 2013, Borisov technically became the oldest professional footballer in Bulgarian history when he played a second-tier game for Vitosha following their promotion at the age of 54. And if you think that's strange, in 2008, he beat Dimitar Berbatov by a narrow margin to be named as Bulgarian Footballer of the Year, but he turned down the award, handing Berbatov the fifth of his record 7 successes in terms of the individual accolade. Given all the assassinations, corruption, and shady characters that have decorated Bulgarian football since long before Kirill and Georgi Domusheyev arrived to fire their €500 notes around, it would not be fair to say that Ludogorets have corrupted Bulgarian football. That would be like saying a man who broke into a morgue and took a shit on the floor had ruined the ambiance. Don't get me wrong, he hasn't helped, and you could quite reasonably suggest that he has made things even worse, but it was hardly Woodstock before he arrived. and that is Ludogorets in so many respects. The man defecating in a morgue. In a world of strangeness and criminals, they remain the social pariahs. Hatred of Ludogorets in many respects is just inevitable, even if their success were to be entirely legitimate. They are a club with no history and virtually no fans who have been bankrolled to the top and created a virtual monopoly on Bulgarian football. Meanwhile, clubs with significant long-term support and tradition have been left feeding off the scraps. In their first season in the top flight, when they won their first Bulgarian championship, Ludogorets averaged just over 4,000 fans in their 10,000-seater stadium, which is named after Domusheyev's pharmaceutical company. That figure has diminished every season since, down to an average of just 1,600 last season. As those of you who watched the Sheriff Tiraspol video not long ago will recall, routine domination of a league becomes boring not just for everyone else, but also for the team that dominates the league. Bulgarian football is in a sorry state, whichever way you look at it, and you can probably now understand how the Bulgarian national team has declined so dramatically in recent years. And if there's one thing I've learnt about Bulgaria, either at school or whilst making this video, it's that the word mafia alone tends to be a decent answer to just about any question. So that's it for today's video about Ludogorets. Thank you all as ever for watching, I sincerely hope you enjoyed it, give us a like if so, let me know your thoughts down below in the comments, and make sure to subscribe and turn on notifications for HITC7s. And as ever, you can follow me on either Twitter or Instagram, or both, via the username @HITC7s on both platforms.